Hi and welcome to the Tech Zone. My name is David. This is Acer's latest 14-inch laptop, Acer Swift 5, and you might wonder what's so special with this device. The most stunning is that the weight comes down to only 990 grams. And how is that possible? Consider the inclusion of a touchscreen. Most other light 14-inch laptops or 13-inch laptops weigh around 1.3 to 1.4 kilograms. It comes down to the material used when producing the unit. The metal chassis is a mix of magnesium lithium and magnesium aluminum, where most other laptops producers rely on aluminum only. The other new thing is the CPU. It includes the latest 10th gen CPU and therefore also the new Iris Graphics G7 that is a giant step up from Intel's UHD 620, and it performs much like Nvidias MX150 10W TDP version. So on the front we have only a plain Acer logo. And checking the device, on the right side we have a USB 2.0 Type A port and a headphone combo jack, and you can see the thickness 15.6 millimeter. It's also a Kensington lock on that side. So on the back you can see the ventilation holes for hot air to escape from this thin chassis. And you can also see on the bottom we have intake for the cool air. Moving on to the left side of the laptop, you can see the port selection here. We have one USB 3.0 Gen 1 port here, and a Type A, and we have also HDMI 2.0, I think it is, port, and also a Thunderbolt port, and that's quite amazing on this relatively cheap laptop. This is a 4-lane PCIe port, and it supports transfer of data up to 40 gigabits per second. And that means you can attach an eGPU to this device, and in that eGPU you can put in whatever graphic card you have and play games, AAA titles, even the newest game on an external or internal display. So that is very nice to see on a device of this type. And moving on to the bottom of the device, you can see it's quite a fingerprint magnet. And I haven't opened up this device, but I can only see these screws around the device. It's yeah, four on the front and four on the middle and three on the back. So I think it's quite easy to remove them and change the SSD if you need to do that. So open up the device, you can see the keyboard here, and it's maybe an odd layout for most of you, but it's a Nordic version of keyboard. You can see it's a little bit of flex in most parts here, it's not so sturdy. I don't know what material they are using on the inside here, but the trackpad is quite nice. It's not as good as the high-end ones like the Dell XPS 13 or Lenovo's C940 or something like that, but it's quite okay. And you can see the small function keys is shared by the shortcuts to brightness and volume and so on. And there you can see the logos for the new Core i7 and Iris Plus graphics. Typing is it's a good experience. You can probably type really fast on this device. This is just to show you. The key travel is around 1.3 millimeters. Because you see also the cutout for the fingerprint scanner. It's very fast and very accurate. So Let's move on to the screen. This device has an touch panel, and that is very nice for this price range and the light and thin laptop. So you can see it, yeah, it works as it should. And you can see the gestures are working also, and it's very responsive. So I think that's a good addition to this kind of laptops. And if you like this video, I would really appreciate if you could give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel and support it. That would be very nice. Screen brightness on this device is, it looks like it's around 300 nits. And you can see that's the lowest level, and you can still use the laptop in that mode also. So, and it's also a 96.4 screen to body ratio, so that's very nice. But we have this device, the Acer Swift 14, and you can see it's a little bit different in key layout and trackpad layout, but you can see the screen on the Acer Swift, it's almost all screen. And this device also has doesn't have a touch screen, and but it has the MX150 Nvidia graphic chip on board, so you can see here dimming down the sessions, they are almost identical in screen brightness, and you can see it's not any visual. Maybe the Acer has a little bit brighter screen. And you can see the port selection, it's more or less the same on both devices, but the Acer Swift 14 does not have Thunderbolt enabled USB Type-C port. And that's a shame. I think they should have included that in their device also. Here you can see the keyboard backlight. It has the Acer has three levels of brightness. And here you can see the specification here. It's you can see it, the TDP goes all the way up to on short duration up to 36 watts, and otherwise it's 25 watt unlimited. And now to the benchmarks, and we check them out here and see how this device performs, and also compare it to the Acer Swift 14. You can see the total score 802. You must know that this device only has an Iris graphics, but for being an Iris graphic, it's totally amazing that you can get 800 over 800. But here you can see compared to the Acer Swift MX150 graphics, you can see it's quite a big difference. You can also see that the processor is locked to 15 watt TDP. And the Acer Swift performs. You can play some lighter games, of course. This test is in three parts. And here you can see the results. Total score 2,401, and that's quite a good result. You can see here the temperatures is around 70 degrees, except for a peak at the top of the CPU test. And otherwise you can see the frequency is very low on the second graphic part. That's quite strange, as the temperatures are not so high. And compared here to the Swift 14, you can see it's not so big difference, 2,401 versus 2,600. So that's not a major difference. And here is CloudGate that I also will fast forward. And here you can see the results, 11,660. And here I don't have anything to compare with regarding the Acer Swift 14. But in this case also quite good temperatures, except for a peak at 80 degrees, and that's not much. I did also run a battery test playing YouTube for 9.5 hours at 40% brightness, so that's quite good. And here you can see the PC Mark 8 battery accelerated test, 4 hours and 2 minutes. So this is the scores for this specific CPU, and you can see the results here. This is on the GT version, as you can see, so it's the one with the Nvidia MX250. But this is a CPU test, so I guess the results are the same. And now let's move on to a gaming test. So let's try something more fun. This is a game test on the game Call of Duty World War II in campaign mode. So you see the display resolution there, and we have to set that to the lowest for this to work. So here you can see the frame rates on the upper right corner. It's around 40 to 50 frames per second, and that's yeah, it's playable if you're just going to play a little when you're on the train, or yeah, only have the laptop with you and not cannot use the desktop or whatever. So you can see it's yeah, I think it's you can say it's playable, but please give your thoughts in the comment section below regarding this, or other questions you have, of course, because I really need input for my videos and comments, so that would be nice if you can help me with that, so I can evolve this channel. So you see here we are around 55 frames per second, and I can play on this level of frame rates. It's okay for me. I have other games, of course, that I can do videos about, if you like Fortnite or whatever. So this is a fan noise test and a temperature test on the keyboard deck. So you can see this is initial. I haven't started running the test yet, but you can see the keyboard deck is around 30 degrees, and the ambient noise in this room is around 34 decibels, so it's more or less totally silent so far. It shouldn't get so hot because it doesn't have a dedicated GPU, so I guess we will have a low fan noise on the entire test, but this low as 35 decibel, it will probably not last all the 20 minutes. So yeah, fast forwarding, and you can see the temperatures. The fan noise is 35-36 decibel at this time, and the keyboard deck is still low temperatures. Quite amazing. So yeah, impressed so far. I hope you are too, because this is amazing. You see, it's quite cool. The keyboard deck has become a little bit warmer. It was up to 44 degrees on the top of the keyboard deck. And there you can see the results of this test, and you can see the temperatures are not so high. It's 73-74 degrees all the time during this test, so the cooling is working very good. And otherwise this test doesn't show so much. It's maybe I could have run some other benchmark tests to have other results. But this is all for this time. I would really appreciate if you can subscribe to the channel and give it a thumbs up if you liked it. And otherwise, I will see you in the next video. Thank you very much for watching. Bye bye.